Hi, everyone. Welcome back. I'm Michael Sandler, your host on Inspire Nation. If you've ever wanted to live an inspired life and leave the fear behind, then do we have the Inspired and Unstoppable show for you. Today, I'll be speaking with Tama Keeves, visionary heroine, best-selling author, honors graduate of Harvard Law School, and the author of an inspiring new book, A Year Without Fear. And that's just what I want to talk with her about today, about how to live an inspired life, leave your fear behind, and what we can do to become inspired and unstoppable. That plus we'll talk about the Revelation Vacation, the Paradise Cafe, playing it safe in law school, artistic spirit apartments, secret doctors in Chinese restaurants, doodling in village inns, impulse shopping at the tattered cover, and what in the world serving chicken fingers and onion rings has to do with anything. So... Welcome to the show, Tama. Are you ready to shine?
I'm so glad to be here. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much for being here. Before we dive right into things, I almost have to hate to ask, what was your real dream growing up?
My real dream growing up? I wanted to be a writer. I really did. I just, you know, I fell in love with writing in high school and I took creative writing in high school, and the creative writing teacher was gorgeous. So it was like, oh my God, it's a sign. So that was what I loved.
And then what did your, I hate to say this, parents say?
Well, to take you back, I grew up in Brooklyn, New York, and my family was Orthodox Jewish. And so, you know, if you come home and you say you want to be a writer, this isn't good news. I mean, I basically could have said, I want to sell crack, or I want to sell my body to the night. You know, my mother basically said, you're going to write? You're going to write? You're going to starve. You're going to write. And that was the basic go for your dreams talk that I got.
Mom, I want to go race bicycles in Europe. And she's a good Jewish woman, a good Jewish girl, I guess you could say, from Brooklyn herself, went to Barbara Streisand's high school.
Wow.
And almost identical words is
so
what
you
I
know.
I know.
You know, and by the way, and whenever I, you know, whenever I tell this story, I always used to think it was unique to Jewish mothers, but apparently it's, you know, French mothers, Swahili mothers of that many of us got the message early on in life, be reasonable, be practical, play it safe. Don't do what you love. Don't do what moves you. Don't do what rocks your world. And for me, and I'm sure you've had this experience too, for me, what I've found is the safest thing I can do on the planet is what I love, what moves me.
And we are going to dive into that because you played it safe. I'm putting up my air quotes here. By attending Harvard Law School. What does that mean? Because it doesn't sound like that was not the happy route.
You are so artful. Yes, that was not the happy route. That was the prescribed route of, you know, and again, in my culture, it was like, you know, be a doctor, be a lawyer, or marry one, you know, and I got accepted, you know, I bought the party line like a lot of people where I thought, okay, my dreams are frivolous, my ideas don't matter, what I love isn't safe, I'll do what you're supposed to do. And I got accepted to Harvard Law School, and then it was like, oh my God. And I graduated with honors from Harvard Law School. And I always tell people, you know, it's the wonders of what you can do even in fear. You know, when you're in fear and you're not feeling and you're not thinking, you can do incredibly insane things. But it will catch up with you because I was so depressed. You know, when I was practicing law, I was in a major law firm. I was on partnership track. I was doing all the right things. And I just kept feeling like there's got to be something more. You know, there's got to be something more. This can't be life. This can't be success. A friend of mine at the time asked me a fantastic question that just changed my life. And he said, you know, think about it. If you've been this successful doing something you don't love, what could you do with what you love?
I heard you say that on the website, and I got so excited to hear that because that is such a powerful message. Maybe I can have you repeat that one more time for us.
If you're this successful doing what you don't love, what could you do with what you love? And I think a lot of us have that situation that we're, and I know a lot of times people feel like, oh, but I'm not even that successful. You know, I didn't get a degree. I don't have a whatever. But, you know, I always tell my clients, if you're putting a roof over your head, you're breathing, you're getting through this, and you're not even doing what you love, what could you do with what you love?
Woohoo! So from there, you're working on partnership, you're up on the 13th floor, and if I understand right, you're maybe even going to work in a bus, hoping that there'll be some maybe semi-horrific crash where you just won't be able to work anymore, or at least do that work. It sounds like you were incredibly burned out early on and needed a change.
Yes, absolutely. And, you know, it's that it's an incredibly painful situation to be in a world or in a life that looks successful and everybody thinks you're on top of your game. You're making it. This is it. This is the big thing. This is what you're supposed to do in life. And you're doing it. But you feel empty and you feel meaningless. And so I started disintegrating inside. I started feeling like, what is wrong with me? Something is terribly wrong. I have, quote, success, but I'm so miserable. And by the way, what I always tell my career coaching clients is, you're supposed to feel miserable. If you're not doing what you love, if you are not doing what you are meant to do on this planet, if you are not listening to that inner voice, you're supposed to be in pain. You're supposed to be, because that's how the universe gets your attention. But you're right. I'm on that bus and I'm secretly willing to take out 30 innocent people. I just don't want to get there. And it was very sad. I really got to the point of not wanting to live anymore. You know, I really got to that point of feeling like, because at the time I didn't have a spiritual life. Mm-hmm. And at the time I didn't know things like inner voice or anything like that. And I just thought, well, I went to the top of the game and it didn't work for me. So now what else is there? But I think a lot of people have that experience that it's the greatest pain in your life that wakes you up to your greatest potential. So I just wanted to say that, like, if listeners are listening and thinking, oh my God, I feel empty, or I'm not sure what I'm supposed to do, that's a good sign. You know, that means there's something knocking at your door.
I'm a coach as well. And when people get to that place, I have to be careful because I don't want to have a true party, but I really want to congratulate them because I know that change is coming. Like it or not, you're going to start living a different way. There's no choice at this point.
Absolutely. I know. It's like, you don't want to go, oh, wow, you're in pain. This is great. But it is, because, you know, pain is what gets our attention, you know. Most of us won't make a change without it. So absolutely. So that is what began my whole life, though, because I was pretty close-minded at the time, you know, of just thinking, I bought into the track of, you have to have a good job, you have to have a degree, you have to make money, that's what you have to do. And when you hit enough pain, you become open-minded, and I realized, I've got to find a way to find meaning and love. And again, if I've been this successful doing something I don't even love, I want to know in my lifetime, in my one precious lifetime, where would love take me? Where would, you know, that secret dream of writing, where could it go? So that's what I did. I decided, you get one life. I want to know. And I walked out of that job without a plan, without a husband. Everybody always thinks that, you know, because I was an attorney, I was making money, but I was stupid. I was spending it, you know, so that's what began everything.
What's pretty cool is, if I understand right, you took a vacation, you're there by the ocean, you call it a revelation vacation, and you're like, I can't go back. And you made a deal with yourself. You said, I'm going to take 3 months away, let's see what happens. Mm-hmm. What was it like stepping off of the cliff, stepping off into the abyss?
Oh, I mean, it's exhilarating. It's terrifying. And again, please keep in mind, maybe other people don't have this as much, but I had so much at stake in my identity. You know, I really had bought in that was where security was. And to walk out into an abyss without a plan, without a job, without anything, in the culture I grew up in and in the culture and the world I was walking in, you just don't do that, you know. But on another level, it was exhilarating. It was this free fall. And again, I'd also been in so much pain, mm-hmm, that I felt like, what have I got to lose? If I'm willing to die, would I be willing to live? Would I be willing to find out? Would I be willing to try it? And for me, it was this, I almost want to say this rush of excitement and wanting to cry of like giving my little girl a chance, you know, giving that younger self a chance that I'd always wanted to write. I'd always wanted to be creative, but that was squelched and that was considered frivolous and stupid. And now I was giving her a chance. So it was a very beautiful, beautiful time.
So in that beautiful time, you end up, and thank you so much for sharing, you end up at a place called the Paradise Cafe.
You're taking me down memory lane. This is all in my first book, This Time I Dance.
Well, it's a yes. Beautiful dance because there are so many of us who are going through this or are wanting to step out and are going to have to molt. They're going to have to let go of the and here you are going from being a high-priced attorney to serving onion rings and chicken fingers. It doesn't get any better than this.
I know. My mother thought it could get better than that. I would get the calls, you're serving nachos now with a Harvard law degree. You know, so I did that. I decided I had never given myself a chance to find out what I loved. And, you know, and I always want to tell people that to find out what you love and to find out what you're meant to do on this earth and to give it a chance, you want to give yourself some time. I don't ever want somebody putting pressure on themselves like, okay, I'm giving myself 3 months and I've got to figure it all out and I've got to get up and running. That I knew early on that I wanted to find something that would pay some of my bills, or I call it a dropout job, you know, just something that would pay some bills, would give me some kind of structure, but wouldn't negate the journey I was on. I already had my job, already had my vocation. My vocation was listening to this inner source and this inner voice and becoming a writer. And I'd never done anything like waiting tables. Like that sounded like crazy fun to me. But the ego in me, of course, and the practical part of my brain was going, are you out of your mind? You can't touch people's food. You can't do that for a living. But one of the things I remembered thinking was that I had gone to law school to increase my opportunities, not to limit them. To increase my opportunities, not to limit them. And so I just want people thinking like many times we're creating safety for ourselves, but we use it to limit ourselves. We get limited by this identity that we think we are instead of opening up to everything we can be, anything we can be, and listening to that wild, wondrous inner voice in us that's going to take you down an inspired path like you can't imagine. So that was my first crazy fun thing to do.
There's something really special in there, which is that you were talking about it a minute ago. You needed to hit the pause button and you need others to hit the pause button because you were on a go, go, go track your whole way through Harvard Law School, all the way up to the 13th floor. It was go, go, go. If you then transplant it and say, okay, I'm supposed to be a writer, let's go, go, go. You did yourself a complete disservice.
Yes. Yes, exactly. And I didn't realize that at the time because I was a go, go, go type A person and let's make it happen and I can bill hours. But you literally can't do it. I say in one of my books that it takes an intermission to find a mission. It takes an intermission to find a mission. And I have in This Time I Dance, I have a chapter called The Year of Sleeping Dangerously because I needed to rest and I needed to undo. And what people don't realize is everybody wants, what are the steps? What are the steps? How do I do this? How do I do this? And what I'll always tell you is that this is a path of undoing. It's not so much a path of doing. It's undoing the thoughts that you've had that are in the way and undoing the blocks in the way. So very often it's a very receptive path, which drives doers crazy. But that really is, and it drove me crazy, which is why I write about it because I am my market. You know, I've had to train my brain that you are doing more by undoing, you know? So in fact, in A Year Without Fear, my third book, that really is what that book is about. It's the tiny mindset shifts that help you undo and listen and know a next step.
It's beautiful. Each day you get a different lesson in peeling away a layer of the onion, of undoing the construct, in a sense, that we've been given that we don't even realize that's not mine.
Yes, yes.
So from there, how do we start to get, well, maybe let's dive into this a little bit more. Let's go into your story just a little bit more. First off, who's your friend Keir?
God. He was my friend Keir. He at that time, he was someone I met along the way that was opened me up to the spiritual world. You know, like, again, at the time I was very closed-minded and I was like, get that crap away from me and I don't need that. And then when you're in enough pain, it's like, okay, teach me anything, anything, give me peace. And so he really was an ally on the path that I had met at the time that had really opened up my world.
And it sounds like one of the things he was doing, and this is a big theme here, is everything that you're doing up until you show up at the beach was all up here, all up
yes.
in the head. And
yes.
now you are undoing that. You're saying, okay, that helps me get across the street, but that's not a great guide for life, and figuring how to drop down here to get
yes.
back heart-centered.
Exactly. And again, so much of my own inner work has been, and so much about the work that I do with others is that, you know, our culture doesn't value that. Our culture thinks that spirituality or creativity is soft and airy-fairy. And I'm a very practical woman. And what I've learned is that the inspired path and my own spiritual journey is the most practical thing there is. Living from your heart, living from your soul, living from your gut, for me, is the safest thing you are ever going to do on this planet. And that's part of my mission, is to legitimize that, is to make that, to translate to people like me who have very active minds and active brains that go, but wait a second, you got to pay the rent, blah, 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 of to do that translation. So Keir was very good at helping me start opening up to different possibilities. And he was the first person who introduced me to A Course in Miracles, actually, which I then began studying and teaching.
Very cool. And, you know, it's really interesting when it comes to receiving. Well, if it comes to the head versus heart, when we think job, we think job. When we think marriage, it comes from the heart. Why does one thing, you would never, at least in today's day and age, in most societies, never look at a balance sheet and say, well, this is the person I think I should marry. We go off.
I think some people would actually look at the balance sheet, but yes.
And that might explain some of the divorce rates.
In my culture, what? I don't get your heart, your schmuck. What does he make?
Oh, no. Oy vey. All right.
I get the point. Yes.
So how did you end up writing that book and getting your first book deal?
Oh, that's an amazing process, an amazing story. And actually, I tell a lot of the story in This Time I Dance, my first book, and also in Inspired and Unstoppable. First of all, it took me 12 years to write my first book. You know, it wasn't like an overnight thing. And people sometimes hear that and get depressed. Like, oh, my God, I don't have that kind of time. But I always tell people, it took me 11 years to heal. Mm-hmm. You know, like what we were talking about before about undoing beliefs. It took me 11 years to trust that I had something valuable, and that I could trust this universe, and that I could trust this love, and that I wasn't just delusional. It took me 11 years to trust that, and 1 year to write a book, I think. So I'm writing this book. I don't have an agent. I don't have a contract. I don't have a publisher. But I am following that inner voice, which is the source of my work. I'm following this voice that is telling me to do this. And I'll try to make this story short. At the end of 12 years, I finally decided I was going to self-publish the book. Mm-hmm. I didn't know what to do. I was asking my inner voice, how do I get it out there? Should I do commercial publishing? Should I do self-publishing? Whatever. And I just kept hearing a voice that literally said, just put it in the river. Just put it in the river. And at first it was like, well, what the hell does that mean? But I knew intuitively it meant self-publish it, put it out there in the stream of life. If it's supposed to go somewhere, it will. But that was terrifying. And, you know, you meet all kinds of people and like, what are you doing with your life? And you don't want to tell them, oh, I'm putting my life's work in a river. you know? So, but basically, I finally got the guts. I self-published the book. And again, this is without an agent, a contract, anything. And 4 months after I self-published the book, I got an email out of the blue that literally said, "Your fairy godmother has arrived. Your fairy godmother has arrived." And, you know, you get an email like that, you're going to think, okay, this is spam. You know, it's
oh,
Russian
no, I
girls
want
are
these
waiting
emails.
For you. You know, like it's a scam deal. They want my money, right? But it was actually a vice president of marketing and publicity for Random House. And she had somehow found my self-published book and wrote to me and said, "This is the best book I have ever read on finding your calling and on finding your passion. And I want to get it to a major New York publisher," which was my wildest, wildest dream. And she did. She got it to the president of Tarcher Penguin. They ended up publishing the book. They ended up keeping the exact title. They ended up keeping the exact writing, which as an unknown writer never happens. They edited maybe 10 sentences out of the whole book. And for me, this was such a life-changing moment because one of the things that I teach my clients all the time is that you can't plan an inspired life. You can't plan an inspired life. You are never going to figure this out. I could never figure out in the 12 years that I'm melting down writing this book thinking, am I nuts? Am I crazy? What am I doing? I could never have thought I'm gonna have a meltdown for 12 years. Some other woman's going to have a meltdown at the end of 12 years because she was looking on the internet to change her job. We found each other, and that was how it happened. It was amazing.
How do you teach people from there? And it is, I'm having such goosebumps and things on so many different levels because we ended up working with Random House, Tarcher Penguin, after self-publishing ourselves.
Oh, wow.
I
didn't know that.
There are so many. We ended up with a division called Three Rivers Press.
Oh, yes.
And so a very interesting, somewhat different in that we ended up putting it out there. We did very well independently after putting it in the river and doing kind of the Wayne Dyer approach of driving the whole country with books with books in the trailer. And then we ended up with we had basically run out of funds to continue. And we're like, we have to do something. And we had a second book in the works. And I'm like, well, I don't want to stop that. And I ended up having to stop my path, what I thought was the direction to go in, find an agent. Agent magically appeared. Mm-hmm. And then in no time had 10 publishers vying for the rights and a 10-publisher bidding war that was won by Three Rivers Press, you know, Random House, and going, this could never, ever, ever, ever have been planned for.
Exactly. You can't plan an inspired life. And so many people are trying to figure out their life and they think they're being practical and they think they're being reasonable and they think that's good judgment. And what I want people to know is that there's already a plan within you. There's already a plan within you. There's already an inspired path within you. And it really is about trusting that. It really is about, and as you probably know, it's just, it gets revealed moment by moment. I've never gotten guidance that said, okay, here it is. Here's your 10-year plan. And here's how we're going to do it. And here's how we're going to fund it. It's moment by moment. It's like following breadcrumbs.
I love that. You talked about in A Year Without Fear, following breadcrumbs and gingerbread houses.
Exactly. Exactly. And most of us are so impatient. You know, most of us, again, and again, for me, this is so much about learning step by step, moment by moment. How do I hear the inspiration in me now? How do I hear the love in me now? And the reason people aren't hearing their inspiration or they aren't hearing their love is because they're listening to fear. Is because they're listening to something in their minds. And unfortunately, fear is often sounding like practicality. It's often sounding like, well, you have to do this. There's no other choice. You have to do this.
It's interesting. There's the Einstein quote. I believe you've used it. We use it all the time that talks about you can never come up with a solution to your problem at the same level at which it was created. So if you were living your life from a place of fear before you took a step back and said, I'm going to go another direction, then you're probably still living it out of fear, even though you've taken the other direction.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And what I see for so many people is you don't realize you're living in fear. You don't realize you're living in smallness. You think, again, you think it's practical. You think it's reasonable. You think there are no other options. But when you tap your inspired mind and you tap that unlimited self and you tap that love in the universe, you start realizing how much you've prescribed yourself to what you know. And an inspired path is what you don't know, what you could never, I could never have imagined that I was going to self-publish that book and someone was going to find it, you know, of, and that it was going to lead me to the dream publisher. That was the dream I had always had, you know? And so again, and what I do want people to know with that is because sometimes I talk and I speak all over the country and I guide people in workshops and then people go, oh, I want to meet my fairy godmother. I want to meet my fairy godmother, you know? And, for me, again, you can't plan that, you know, and it doesn't negate that I spent years working at this and you spent years working at what your book, you know, and doing the next step and doing the next step. And for me, that's really what this path is.
Well, the real fairy godmother was you.
Yes. Yes. Very powerful insight. Very powerful insight. And the real fairy godmother is in all of us. It's that inspired mind. It's who you are when you're thinking in love instead of fear. It's who you are when you're recognizing your possibilities. And again, most of us are listening to other people's voices. You know, you might be listening to the voice of your parent, or you might be listening to the voice of society, or good judgment, or what you read in the Wall Street Journal. And you think you don't even realize that's not your voice, you know, and I want to know what your voice says and what your heart says and what your gut says. And to your point, that is the fairy godmother, you know, that is the infinite power within us because we all have our own way. And for me, that's what this lifetime is for, is to discover that way.
How do we start to strip away more of the undoing to realize who we truly are?
I think the biggest thing that you can do is that, first of all, you recognize it. You know, first of all, you recognize that, okay, even though I think I'm being practical, I think I'm being reasonable, this could be fear speaking to me. This could be a limited voice. This could be a smaller voice speaking to me. But I think the biggest thing that you can do is you can follow your desire. You know, the biggest thing you can do is follow your desire. What do you want? What do you love? And again, most people go, oh God, Tim, I ask myself that question all the time. I don't know. I don't know. But that's not true. You do know. You know, there's always an answer. It's that we think we can't have it. We think we're too old. We think we're too young. We think we need a degree. We think it's whatever. And so the first thing I would say right now, just even as you're listening, anything you love, anything that moves you, I promise you, if you do it, if you take a step towards it, you will change your brain chemistry. You will change your energy. You will change your love. You will change the way that you feel in life. And so that's my biggest step is really start focusing on what you love. Start focusing on what moves you because what you focus on grows.
Thank you. Thank you. On that note, people, let's help people with this important step, which is there a one right step versus a wrong step?
Oh, what an interesting question. I personally don't believe that. When I wrote Inspired and Unstoppable, which is my second book, it was more about, you have the dream and you have the passion and you're putting it out in the world. And then you get overwhelmed because you're like reading all these right steps and all the formulas. You know, if you're this, you have to do this. And here's mm-hmm. the 10 easy ways and the mistakes you don't want to make. And I got so overwhelmed. And I started making that distinction in my head thinking, okay, well, this is my spiritual journey and my love. But then there's business. And then there's, you know, the way you're supposed to. And my own healing was recognizing that the same inspired voice that gave me the dreams would also give me the means. The same inspired voice that gave me the dreams would also give me the means. And so by that, I want people ignoring anything that tells you there's one right way to do it and there's only this and you need to know it. I don't believe that. I deeply know that you're a creative being. You're an inspired being and you might have a way that is so completely different than anybody else and it's the only way that's going to work for you. So I keep having to find that in my own life. I keep having to ignore standard business principles and really listen to what gives me energy. What gives me energy? If it gives me energy, it's right.
There's recently we got, and you saw here just before the show, a kitty cat in our lives, my wife and myself, Jessica. She's the producer of the show as well. And I was pointing out kitty cat to you, and we know we're moving soon. And so in theory, the worst thing that you want, worst in quotes, is to have another being with you before you move. And we said to ourselves, this makes absolutely no sense. It feels right. We got to do it.
Exactly. Exactly. And it's never a wrong thing to have a cat anyway. That goes beyond, transcend every law of the nature. But to your point, that's a beautiful, beautiful point of, you know, there's the formulaic way to do things. And then there's the inspired way of, I don't know why we chose to have a cat right now, but it feels good and we're going with it.
Absolutely. So let's talk briefly about, you mentioned that you've written about A Course in Miracles. And I want to talk a little bit about love and fear. If you can walk us down that road a little bit.
So I've now been teaching A Course in Miracles for like 25 years or so, or something astronomical. And for me, it runs rampant in all my books. So in any of the books, and in fact, A Year Without Fear, the 5-Minute Mindset Shift book is me taking a lot of the concepts from A Course in Miracles and putting them into very practical, fun, easy, coachable ways. Because for many people, A Course in Miracles can be challenging to read. Mm-hmm. And so I put it into more, usable, applicable language. But A Course in Miracles is all about, how do I live in love instead of fear, right? How do, at every single minute, there's this choice point in your life of every single minute, there's a choice point of, am I coming from love or am I coming from fear? And love, by the way, doesn't have to be romantic love and, oh my God, I love this, but just that wholeness and that knowing and that connection, because we are all deeply vehicles of something else. What excites me in this world is there are people like me and there are people like you and there are people all over this world that have this untapped potential in them, this genius in them, this light in them. And every one of us is playing smaller than we can. We're, you know, again, we're staying safer, and it's not safer. And so my fun and excitement is helping people tap and open up to that brilliance that's in them moment by moment, and in relationships with other people too.
It must drive you absolutely crazy. It does drive me crazy when you see someone who's playing life small, and everybody has amazing possibilities in them, but when you can see it so clearly.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. And one of the things that I teach from A Course in Miracles, and again, it's in all my books as well, is that if I can help somebody feel safer, if I can create that, you know, it's like what I do in an event, at one of my retreats. If I can co-create that safe space where you just feel more relaxed and safe to be who you are, even if you are in fear and you're not ready to make a leap, you know, for me, it's that safety that will undo the fear. And one of the things I want to say about a leap is, a leap isn't right for everybody. You know, like for me, a leap, you know, I'm a very timid person. Everybody always thinks that, oh, you make these big changes. It's like, I'm a neurotic Jew. Are you kidding? You know, like, I am not going spelunking anytime in this lifetime, you know, so a lot of times the leap can be these tiny, small adjustments. You know, not everybody needs to walk out of a career or walk out of a marriage or become a spiritual channeler. It might just be something, you know, I have a lot of clients that are doing things they love on the side, are experimenting on the side. So again, when you're hearing leap, I just want you to think about the next right thing for you or what feels good to you, because it will always be expanding your comfort zone. And I'm sure you have that same experience. I'm continuing to grow. I'm always facing my lack of comfort zone, you know, and I'm always playing smaller and trying to get myself to play bigger. So it's an ongoing evolution.
Now, Jessica and I have been walking around lately, particularly her with me, and going, nope, that's a limiting belief. Nope, that's a limiting belief. That's a limiting belief. And really stopping me at each turn to challenge me to keep playing bigger and bigger and bigger still. And I don't think we realize how big of a game we can play. Everything, almost everything, is a limitation we play based on ourselves.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Because I think we are either limiting, we are either listening to a power in us that's a limited belief inside us that has no power, mm-hmm. or we're going to listen to a power that's unlimited. You know, that's the choice. And again, I think most of us don't even realize it. And so it's just an experimentation. It's just a gradual experimentation. And for me, I know I have to make it okay that maybe I'm not ready yet. You know, like I can be, you know, because a lot of times, you know, you're in the spiritual world and you're thinking, oh my God, I'm thinking this negative thought and I'm creating this and I'm limiting, oh, I'm playing small. And now I'm thinking of playing small thoughts. I'm
attracting small. Breathe.
And so I have to give myself permission to be where I am and to know that I will develop in my own time and way and that I will reach for that light when I'm ready to. And if I'm not ready, pain will come along and or frustration will come along and then it will guide me to that.
Mm-hmm. It's an expression I use particularly after the cosmic 2x4 got me a couple times. Kind, gentle, easy, good. May I move forward. Kind, gentle, easy, good.
I love it. Love it.
How do we put ourselves in the flow of love?
So much of this work for me is about developing that loving relationship with yourself.
Yes.
You know, of that. I think the biggest thing I've had to learn on this path, you know, I thought I was going on this career change, you know, this big, huge career change of I'm finally going to do what I love and I'm going to be a best-selling author and I'm going to whatever. And I'm sure you know all the, you know, ins and outs of that and pain of that, right? That it's not like what it looks like on paper sometimes. The greatest gift I have learned in this lifetime is how to continuously love and champion myself. Because the world is not doing it for me. And nobody made me a great author and nobody made me a good business person. I've had to work with my own mind and I've had to encounter where I'm not being loving, you know, where I'm being cruel to myself, where I'm being demanding, where I'm pushing, where I'm comparing myself to somebody else, you know. And so the greatest gift I've gotten out of this lifetime is to learn how to start being kinder to myself and loving with myself and truly loving, not the conditional loving like, woohoo, I love you if you succeed, baby. Ooh, you won. I love you now. I knew how to do that. But to really have that unconditional love that says, I'm so proud of who I am because I'm daring this in my lifetime. And if I succeed, that's fabulous. And if I fail, that's a growth or a learning and that's hard. And I don't even believe in failure at this point. But I'm at least giving myself that chance. So for me, putting myself in the flow of love means continually blessing myself and championing myself and getting behind myself and not expecting the world to, so that when I'm in front of an audience or I'm writing a new book for readers, of course I want them to love it. And of course I want them to praise it, but I need to strengthen that in me first.
That is, as you describe, probably the bravest and most courageous thing we can do.
Yes, it is. And it's ongoing because again, the world teaches us, you're a superstar if everybody else loves you. You're a superstar if you have the numbers. You're a superstar if you have money. You're a super. But this world is shifting all the time. There's always impermanence. And for me, what really has helped me immensely is my own self-love. And by the way, that gives me latitude to have love for somebody else as well. And it gives me the mental stamina to pursue these crazy, wild dreams all the way. Because the thing that stops people from their dreams is the lack of that mental stamina, is the lack of that possible, you know, they talk themselves out of it. They give up too soon. They think they're failing when they're succeeding. You know, I mean, some of the greatest successes I have had, nobody ever saw. It was the success where I was scared out of my mind and I tried again. That was the biggest success, not when everybody was applauding.
Makes sense. And that is a woohoo.
That is a woohoo.
If somebody comes to you and they want help and they're willing to do the work and the commitment, it's really all about commitment, but they don't have the self-love going on yet, what's the first step they get to take?
You know, so I have a technique I love that I use. I'm not plugging my website, but it is on my website.
Go for it.
Okay. TamaKeeves.com. If you go and you get, if you sign up for, I think it's our newsletter or the Inspired Self Toolkit, you'll get this technique, which is called Inspired Self Dialogues. And again, there's a million different techniques. It's just the technique that I've used forever that really, really works for me, is that I write to the two voices, you know? And so not having the self-love, I wrote from fear. I wrote the negativity, like I'm scared and I want to love myself, but I don't know how. And I feel like a piece of crap or whatever horrible stuff. So you write from your fear. And then, the inspired self-dialogue is when you write back from the voice of love, you write back from the highest presence of spirit you could possibly imagine. And you might have to make it up or fake it, you know, and it may feel awkward. And if you can't think of a loving voice, it may even be what you would say to your child or what you would say to your best friend. And so I teach you in those inspired self dialogues to go back and forth and back and forth. And that's just, for me, that's one technique that's really helpful to really start discovering self-love. But I think the other biggest thing is kind of what we were talking about before, and people dismiss it. Do something you love. Do something that matters. When I let myself imagine that I could really be a writer, when I gave myself that permission, it was like the forbidden thing, the forbidden fruit, like coming out of the closet, like, oh my God, I'm not a lawyer, I'm a writer. That act was the most self-loving thing I've ever done in my life. You know, and so doing anything you love, like if today you're listening and you're thinking, I really want to go for a walk and I don't want to be at my desk, and you listen to that, you know, it's just those subtle little cues of starting to listen to your love and doing what you love that's going to help you tap that other consciousness and change your brain chemistry.
There's another along those exact lines. When you're doing that, when you're saying, I am going to take that walk, you are truly honoring yourself. And when you honor yourself, that comes back tenfold.
Yes, exactly. It's exactly that. And what I want people to understand is that that voice, that little whisper to you that I want to take that walk or I want to write a poem now, I got excited listening to this interview, whatever. That voice isn't just your namby-pamby, like, you know, frivolous voice or whatever. That I think that's the God in you. I think that's the spirit in you. I think that's the soul in you. I think that's the light in you. And it's the tip of the iceberg. Because you know how we were talking about breadcrumbs before? Mm-hmm. You know, what people don't realize is that one inspired act leads to another, leads to another, leads to another. When I first started writing, I had no idea how I was going to build this career. And I started writing poetry at first, which was like, oh my God, going from corporate law to writing poems did not seem like an inspired path, but writing poems led me to writing poetic essays about career transition. And I was reading all the self-help books and everybody was, you know, 5 easy steps and 7 easy formulas. And they found their right life in 20 pages and I'd be angry. And so I wanted to write something like, what do you do when you're in fear? What do you do when you're in panic? And so I started writing these poetic essays about how do you stay inspired when you're scared? And that started becoming a book. And then a book led me to do groups, you know, like to start talking to people. And then talking to people led me to do workshops. And workshops led me to work individually with people. I never knew any of this. So that's why I think an inspired path is one thing will lead you to another and another and another. That's why the first thing you do is you just follow the first thing that comes to you.
Beautiful, beautiful, beautiful. A few quick questions, then we're going to dive into a brief wrap up here. First off, I'm going to follow the breadcrumb of where you just went. What is a step to take to stay inspired when we hit a place of fear?
When you hit a place of fear, first of all, you may not even realize it, you know, so don't beat yourself up if later you realize that, like, whoa. You know, for me, again, I'm just using what I do. I'm not saying it has to be what everybody else does. For me, because I'm so mentally active, that inspired self-dialogue really helps me, because I know that meditation helps many people. Mm-hmm. My mind can be so active and crazy that I need to journal. I need to write it out, because I write the fears out, I get them out, and then I can take that space. So I'm not a biggie on, oh my God, don't think the fear. It's almost like loving it, listening to it, and also knowing that it's not you. And so anything you can do to take space, I think that would be the biggest thing. Anything that you can do to take space and address that fear.
Thank you. What if people say, it sounds rather selfish for me to just go and follow my passion?
Oh, yeah, baby, be selfish.
Thank you.
The reason I say that is, again, I'm going to plant the seed for you and use your own words. You know, if God isn't your thing, or spirit isn't your thing, or light isn't, whatever it is that's your thing, what if it's God speaking to you? What if it's the light speaking to you? What if it's this infinite intelligence that's in you, that's in all of us, that has a, you know, my selfish act of deciding I want to write, that's all I've ever wanted to do, I've now helped tens of thousands of other human beings find their right life or be on that path. That wasn't my intention. I never even, you know, it wasn't like I sat down on a beach and thought, wow, I want to help humanity. I just wanted to breathe. I was totally thinking about me. I was never thinking, wow, I want to help other people. It was like, oh my God, I just want to save my life. I want my life to mean something. I want to find joy somehow, some way. So what I want you to consider, the Course in Miracles says that the Holy Spirit is the voice for joy. The Holy Spirit is the voice for joy. And so I'd like you to imagine that anytime you're being invited to some kind of joy, what if that's your spirit? And what if that spirit not only knows the highest plan for you, but knows the highest plan for humanity as well? That, you know what? It's happy people that will make a difference. It's alive people that will make a difference. We don't need more depressed people. We don't need more angry people. So the happier you are, you're going to be naturally generous, serve your family, and serve this world.
Woohoo!
You're my kind of guy. You're a woohoo guy.
I am woohoo all the way. What do you mean, love is at the wheel?
What I mean by love is at the wheel is that, again, and that's actually one of the mindset shifts in A Year Without Fear, is that remembrance that, you know, sometimes I'm a metaphor girl. And if you've read my writing, you know, there's a million metaphors everywhere. And for me, what it means is sometimes you imagine being on a bus, and the bus is going through different scenery, you know, and I don't like the scenery out there. Like, ew, I don't want to be in the desert, or ew, I don't want to go down this alley or whatever. But you're on the bus, baby, you know, and love is at the wheel. Strength is at the wheel. Goodness is at the wheel. Most of us get caught up in the scenery, or get caught up looking out the window going, this isn't right. This isn't the life I asked for. This can't be the plan. And I just want you to keep in mind that there is a force of goodness and grace in this world that's always at the wheel, but we are not always aware of it. We're not always focused on it. So when I'm focused on my fear, I certainly don't feel like love is at the wheel. Terror is at the wheel. Craziness be home, but love isn't at the wheel. And so for me, it's that remembrance that there is a force of life and grace and goodness and spirit that is always present. And it's my job as the highest human being I can be to use my brilliant mind to focus on that and to find out my own brilliant next steps in love.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. What advice would you give for parents, for their kids, to help them to know love is at the wheel and travel this path themselves?
You know, I think it gets back to the same basic things of really trusting and not pushing away those desires that come. So not being prescribed that, you know, little Johnny wants to be a tattoo artist, you know, like, oh, no, you have to be a banker. No, you have to go to school. No, you have to do this. And as parents, of course, you want to safeguard your child. And it's not an either or. I'm never saying it's an either or. But what I want you to consider is that the voice of love and the voice of desire has so much natural energy, mm-hmm. and so much natural intelligence that you don't even know. So I would foster your child's natural inclinations, where they naturally go, how they naturally move. you know, when I work with a client, I'm a coach for years and I don't have a technique. I don't have a program. I don't have a formula of the seven steps or the way I'm going to bring you through this. I know that each person has this natural brilliance and I'm just going to follow it. I'm going to let them lead me. So I think that the first thing I would say is that ultimately your child has their own destiny and their own genius. And it's not your job to figure that out. It's your job to follow the cues and to indulge them and help them find the things that they love and the things that move them and let that intelligence guide them. Woo-hoo! And to do the same for yourself too.
Amen.
Yes.
So where can people go to find out more, to find your beautiful books? I know you mentioned the website briefly earlier, to get your newsletter. And I think you have an upcoming event or two.
Oh God, I've always got upcoming events. So the best thing you can do, of course, is go to tamakeeves.com, mm-hmm. Sign up to be on the newsletter, sign up to get the Inspired Toolkit, because you'll get a lot of these techniques we're talking about and some audio and video. But the newsletter will keep you the most current of I'm doing events all over the country. I have online programs. I have an Inspired and Unstoppable Life Tribe that's amazing. It's a very, very affordable coaching program. It's 2 times a month with me on the phone and on all kinds of people like us that are conscious and alive all over the world. So there's all kinds of beautiful stuff going on. If you're in the New York area, I am at the New York Open Center coming up in March, and then I'm in California in June. So there's all kinds of great stuff. So the first thing I think is just go to the website. My books are everywhere, in bookstores, Amazon.com, you know, all of it. So, and the other thing is I'm on social media. Follow me every day. I'm on Facebook and Twitter. We have a worldwide community, that's growing consciously and living in love instead of fear. And so for me, I'm always, my newsletters aren't salesy. They're not like buy this, buy that. I do a new article every single month that really helps you tap into your inspiration instead of your fear and the deeper thinking around it, the things that get us blocked and stuck and how to undo that.
Fantastic. And if you're driving down the road and you didn't get the link to get over to Tama, come on over to InspireNationShow.com and we'll get you over to her as well. So before we jump into a brief meditation, yes. What personally brings you the greatest happiness, or what I call the woohoo factor?
Wow, that's interesting. What brings me the greatest happiness or woohoo? Well, it's embarrassing to admit, but I guess I will since you asked. I think of all the things I do in my life, I have to admit, it's all the people who have written into me, all my readers that say, oh my God, I love your book. It changed my life. Or I read this and blah, blah, blah. You know, for me, and even when people have taken workshops or coached with me and have said, oh my God, you're amazing. I love it. I love that. But in all honesty, it's like when people say, your book moved me. It rocked my world. There's something for me because it's my deepest, deepest soul expression and putting it into this world and having that conversation with other people and having people all over the world that you don't even know. You're not your family and friends anymore. They're complete strangers. That's been, for me, that's a moment where every time that happens, I just feel like, okay, you can take me now. I'm good. This is what I came for. I'm good. So, I don't know what that says about me, but it's true.
And that'd be then a woohoo.
That is a woohoo. It's just, it's the right use of my life. I think that's what it is. It's just like, oh my God, I'm doing what I'm meant to do and it's working. That's the most exciting thing I know.
And probably the greatest gift we could wish for anybody.
Yes. Yes.
So on that note, any last words of wisdom you want to share with people before we do a short meditation?
You know, I mean, it's just a reiteration because I think it's so important. I just want people to know that your dreams are not frivolous. You have your dreams for a reason. They're not, you know, I work with so many different people and everybody has different dreams and different variations and it makes you realize that, oh my God, we are all being gifted uniquely and we need your gifts in the world right now more than ever before. You know, everybody's so worried. I worried so much about, am I good enough? Will what I'm going to say good enough? Is this going to go anywhere? Is this useful? And it never occurred to me that my gifts weren't for me. They were for other people. your gifts are not for you. Your gifts are for the people who need you. And there are people who uniquely need you right now. So anybody who's listening that has a dream, a desire, I just want you to know that it's not frivolous. That's your instruction. It's your map. It's your code. And there's somebody who needs you desperately right now. So thank you for listening to it.
So we're going to do a brief meditation at the end. Do you have a meditation program that you want to tell people about?
Absolutely. You know, along with A Year Without Fear, the book, it's a 5-minute mindset shift. I created this program that people have really loved where it's 6-minute meditations every single day. They're audio guided meditations that I've led meditations in classes for years and people have loved them. And so if you sign up for the program, we would do a special because we're on your show and it would be $99 for the year. It's not that on the website. So people could order it on the website and then we could discount them. But basically what it is every single day it arrives in your inbox just as an email with a link that guides you through this meditation for 6 minutes. And that way you have no excuses, no reason not to be undoing fear every single minute. And so what they do is it's just a slightly different way to think every single day. The meditation goes for longer if people want it, but it stops at 6 minutes. I stop talking at 6 minutes just because a lot of people are doing it before work or they just want to fit it in. But you can stay longer if you like, and people use it as a journaling practice. It's been insanely popular. And I like being in people's heads every single day, undoing fear. So it's a great program. And like I said, we would do a special for your audience where it would be $99 for the whole year.
Fantastic. And again, just go over to your website for that.
So basically, if you just go out to the website and you look for A Year Without Fear Daily Mindset Shift program, you can order it. If it's the full price where it's $149 or $159, just order it. And then just if you just email us and tell us that you heard it through the Inspire Nation show, we'll give you that discount where it's $99 for the whole year.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So from there, do you have a brief meditation you wouldn't mind sharing with us?
Let's do it.
Perfect.
Yay. And thank you so much, Michael, for your amazing work in the world. Thank you so much for what you're doing. I really appreciate it. So
it goes both ways. And I love what you're doing. And I love your energy. And you were brave. Which loosely translated means you rock.
Yeah, rock, baby. I'm insane. I'm brave. I rock. And by the way, just for listeners, and it's a moment by moment journey, because if you read my books or if you read my journal, which you're never going to be able to read, it's all filled with fear. You know, like in all my books, you know, they're all filled with the fears of this fear and that fear. So I just want people to know that bravery doesn't mean you don't have fear. It means that you keep walking forward, that you keep making the next choice. So that's what we'll do in the meditation.
Awesome. Perfect. Right.
Okay, so let's take a deep breath together.
And if you're driving down the road, you might want to wait till later to do this.
Yeah, that's right. Or you might want to just pull on over because life is worth it. This is your moment and we're going in. All right, so together we take a deeper breath. And if it helps you at all to place your hand on your heart or any gesture that is comforting to you, that is guiding to you, that lets you connect, just take this moment. And together we begin by taking the deepest breath into the core of our beingness, the core of our beingness, the core of our beingness. And I'd like you to let go and let go and let go. And together as we take this moment, we are asking to co-create a safe and a sacred space, a safe and a sacred space for all of us, that even if we are in different time zones and different countries and different states of mind, we are now attuning, all of us, we are now attuning together. The light in my mind reaches the light in yours. The light in your mind reaches the light in mine. Our hearts are joining and we are becoming this unified field of consciousness. So for a moment, just begin. Perhaps reminding yourself, I am safe. No matter what is going on, I am safe. No matter what it looks like, I'm safe. And no matter what has gone in my life, no matter what my past looks like, no matter what my future looks like, I am dropping down into inspired time. I am beginning again. I am beginning again in this moment. I'm giving myself permission to open up to all that is in this moment. I let go of my past, if even for an instant. I let go of my past. I let go of anything I think the future needs to be. And I truly give myself permission in this moment to truly begin again. To truly listen, to receive. I'm no longer listening to what my mind tells me what is possible. I'm opening up to the inspired guide within me. With each breath that I take, I remind myself, I am safe. I am loved. I am safe. I am loved. I am safe. I am loved. And the more that my mind joins this consciousness, the more I relax. And the more I relax, the more my body softens. I am safe. And I am loved. I am safe. And I am loved. And the more that I receive this knowing from the deepest self within me, I'm attuning myself to my inner voice, the only voice that's real. I only want to hear the one voice that is real, the voice of love. The voice of love. I invite the highest spirit, my inner teacher, this beloved guide, to guide me. I let go of everything, of what I think needs to happen right now. And I breathe into this possible moment, joined by all these souls. My light is joined with theirs, and theirs is joined with mine. And we together are creating this unified field. I am safe, and I'm loved. I'm safe, and I'm loved. Letting yourself rest. I am infinitely guided. I am safe, and I am loved. And as you rest in this space, reminding yourself, I am safe, and I am loved. What is it that your inner voice wants you to know right now? Not forcing, not striving, just allowing and allowing and allowing. And maybe it comes now, maybe it comes another time. But I'm asking my inner teacher, my inner love, what would you have me know right now? What is it that you would have me know? Perhaps a word comes to you.
perhaps an image, perhaps a memory, perhaps a feeling, perhaps a knowing. What is it that you would have me know, dear one? I allow myself to receive whatever I need to receive. I allow myself to receive whatever I need to receive. And in this time and space, is there something, anything that you know that you would love? Is there anything? Is there a dream or a whisper or an ache or a moment or an inclination? It could be very, very small. It could be very, very large. As you ask your inner teacher, what is it? Is there something I love that I want more of right now in my life? Is there a next step, or is there an idea? Is there a whisper? Not forcing, just allowing anything. Maybe it comes now, maybe it comes another time. I receive what I need to receive. I receive what I need to receive. I am safe. I am loved. I'm guided. I am safe. I am loved. I am guided. And I'm receiving whatever I need to receive. And for a moment more, we hold the thought together as a group, as everyone who is listening right now, every one of us guided right now, even if we're listening at a different time, their minds are joined. We hold the highest intention and the highest love for each of us. Your thoughts matter. Your intention matters. I ask for the highest love and the highest grace and the infinite intelligence for everyone hearing this. And we are joining in that collectively together and blessing one another. And allowing ourselves to receive all of this blessings and all this light and all this love that is coming to us. We've now activated an inspired time. We have together activated this inspired time, and we'll pay attention to whatever happens. Holding that thought and blessing yourself, forgiving yourself this moment, this experience. I'm willing to listen and receive. I am loved. I'm guided. I'm on my path. I'm unstoppable. I'm where I need to be, and I'm opening up to everything that I am meant to be. Taking in a deeper, deeper breath and letting everything else go. Everything else go. What do you know right now? That's all that matters. And then as you feel ready and in your own time, just begin to allow your precious mind to return. Begin to allow your precious mind to return. In your own time and way, together we are beginning again. We are now entering a new realm. We've activated this together. We are so grateful for one another, all of us who are making these brave, conscious choices. We're so grateful for each other and allowing your mind to return as it does and coming back to this time and space.
Woohoo!
Yeah. a joint woohoo.
I love it.
Well, thank you.
Thank you so much, Tama. This has been so, so much fun.
Oh, good. Thank you. Same here. You're amazing.
And you as well. So, got to crank it up for the finish here. I'm in meditation mode. For everyone out there, this is Michael Sandler saying, be well, have fun, get a year without fear, and start living an inspired life today, and shine bright.
Right on! Woo-hoo!
Thanks so much for watching. If you enjoyed it, be sure to like below. Also, leave your comments. Have some real fun with it. Subscribe to our channel where you're going to get more great videos, more interviews coming up. And check out our website, inspirenationshow.com. That's where you'll find tips, blogs, information, videos you won't find anywhere else, and useful and helpful resources to really help you kickstart your life and to shine bright. Thanks so much again. Thank you for your support. Like, comment, subscribe. See the website. Thanks so much and have fun. Of course, shine bright. Woohoo!